Amen. Give yourself a hand in the Lord. Got to enjoy yourself in Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? We're in for a marvelous ride here at Southeast Community Church. Amen. Amen. God is good all the time. Y'all look mighty good today. Amen. Cowboys and cowgirls in the house. Amen. 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 We're going to go west for a long time. Amen. Amen. We're having a leadership meeting tonight. Amen. 5 o'clock. I'm asking all leaders, if you are leading in any capacity, in any ministry, they're going to get me right. In any ministry, I want you here. Amen. Because I think the church rises and falls on leadership, and it can't all be placed on my back. You have to accept responsibility for the growth of the church and, of course, being faithful to the Lord. Every leader has to accept that responsibility. What am I doing to make my church better? Can you say amen? Amen. First John. Chapter 1, verse 1, amen, through verse 4. Hopefully have that on your screen, amen. Now, this is just a fun day for me. I thank God for all the people who work to put everything together for you coming dressed up in your Western get-ups. The prayer warriors that prayed on yesterday, men came out, manicured churchyard, did a lot of things. We wanted to have some horses for our children to ride today, but we got a little late in planning. It'd be a great thing for them to experience. Keep broadening their horizons. You're not gonna be in a church where we're gonna limit our children's exposure, so you ain't gotta worry about that part. We're going to keep broadening our children horizon, but you got to come go with me. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. God is good all the time. Okay. Let me see. Can I pick this text up in your hearing? All right. John, 1 John 1, verse 1. That which was from the beginning, say from the beginning.
From the beginning.
Which we have heard. Which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled. Hear the text. Concerning the word of life. Could have said Jesus. But notice the emphasis. The Holy Spirit says he is the word of life. The life was manifested. That's a possession there. The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that not just life now, but it's what? Eternal life. There are two possessions there, which was with the Father and was manifested life, eternal life to us. That which we have, keep saying it, seen and heard, we declare to you that you also may have fellowship. Say fellowship.
Fellowship.
So the whole point is that you have fellowship.
Amen.
It's been told to you. We've seen it. We've heard it. We've handled it. We want you to have fellowship with us, and truly. He makes the emphasis here, using that adverb. Our fellowship is with who?
The Father.
And?
His Son.
His Son. If you know Jesus, you know God.
Right.
You can't know God without knowing Jesus. And these things we write that your joy, there's a joy issue here. I'm writing this because I understand that some people have lost their that your joy may be full, which by implication could mean it is not yet full right now, or it could be what? Empty. I'm writing it because I want you to experience, as believers, full joy. Somebody say full joy.
Full joy.
You may be seated. I want to talk about how to maintain the thrill of being a Christian. How to maintain the thrill of being a Christian. Realtors and salespersons understand that there is a thrill when consumers make a new purchase. That there is a body chemistry reaction to a significant purchase, something that you may have not realized. Documented researchers identify certain chemical changes buyers experience when making a purchase that is significant in terms of its cost. A significant purchase is not a candy bar, something I always like to buy. For most people, it is something over $300. As a person moves to the stage of purchasing it, their heart rate begins to increase. Their pupils dilate. The body releases adrenaline, protein, hormones, and enzymes. You get all excited just because you're about to make a major purchase. In short, no matter how calm a person may appear on the outside, on the inside, he or she is getting excited. Any one of these chemical changes in excess could be exhibited by drug addiction or by a drug addict getting high. In other words, that there are some purchases that you literally can make that can get you high, that can bring a rush of adrenaline in your life. Have I got a witness here? The buyer does get a small rush from making these purchases. That's why some people get addicted to shopping. When they're depressed, they gotta go shop. Things go wrong in their life, they gotta go buy some. When it seems like they don't have any money, they gotta find a way to get some money in order just to buy something. It's a rush, it's a high. Just like new relationships, when you fall in love, you're in cloud nine. You know, your feet are off the ground. It's a rush to be in a new relationship. And even substance abusers are still chasing that first hit because it's a rush. They keep hitting it, but listen, 1,000 times is not enough, and one is too many. It's just a rush. And there's always a thrill when you are getting into something brand new or something significant. And John realized that, because when he wrote this book, it's 40 years after the cross, 40 years after the resurrection. William Barclay suggests that the thrill of the first days were now gone. Feelings arose that the standards for Christianity now were just too high. Coming to church every Sunday now is just too high. Praying every day now. I used to pray every day, but praying every day now is just too high. Used to read my Bible every day, but just doing it every day now, that's a little bit too much for me. Listen to me. They began slowly being seduced from the beaten path that they had once enthusiastically so embraced. They were on fire for Jesus Christ. They had a passion to love the Lord and to proclaim his name. But now they were being surrounded by uncertainty and confusion, which breeds insecurity into our relationship. And when you have uncertainty and confusion and insecurity, it kills the thrill of what you believe would last for a lifetime. Amen, lights and walls. No relationship can maintain its thrill when it is infused with insecurity, when it is infused with uncertainty, when it is infused with confusion. And so John seeks to correct the record
Because some folk have said that Jesus did not actually come in the flesh. That Jesus was not really a living reality. He was a phantom of some sort. But you still can believe in him because you can believe in the spiritual part of Jesus and not the physical part of Jesus. Because anything that's physical is evil. But everything that's spiritual is right. In other words, they had got so heavenly minded there were no earthly good. John is trying to bring them back to earth. He's trying to put the thrill back into the relationship that they once had with Jesus Christ. And so you would ask me, Pastor, how do we maintain the thrill? I'll tell you how you can maintain that thrill. The first thing you have to do is you've got to reclaim the beginning. You know when you first fell in love? You remember when you first met? You remember how you looked into the eyes of that woman you knew you were going to be with for a lifetime? Have I got somebody? You remember how it felt when he would call you in the morning and you hadn't even seen him? How much thrill you would have, how your heart would palpitate? Have I got somebody? See, what he says, you've got to reclaim the beginning. You remember how it felt when you met Jesus? You remember how it felt when Jesus lifted you? You remember how it felt when he saved you from a burning hell? You've got to go back and reconnect if you've been connected. You see, when you get lost, you back up to the place where you started, where you were most familiar, where you were most comfortable with. Because the feeling of being lost is an insecure feeling. And the lack of thrill is only indication of something has gone wrong in your life. You veered off track. Somewhere along the way, you slacked up in your relationship with Jesus Christ. And now you can't shout hallelujah but on Sunday morning. Because when Monday morning comes, you a different person. The thrill is gone. And so he says in verse 1, he says, it is the word of life. It is Hebrewism, which means the emphasis is after the preposition. It's the word of life. Say life. Life is what you have when you're feeling good. Life is what you have when you got pep in your step and zest in your chest. You got a glide in your stride. That's life. Life is what you have when you first meet Jesus Christ. Life is what you have when you first experience the forgiveness of God in your soul. There's a sense of peace. There's a sense of joy. There's a sense of life. And when you hear the gospel message, it produces life. It makes you walk right. It makes you talk right. It makes you feel better. It produces life. And so he calls it the word of life. He reminds them of the thrill they experienced when they first met Jesus. How did you feel when you came out the wilderness? I felt like shouting, and I did. I felt like dancing, and I did. I felt like praising his name, and I did. I remember the night I got saved, I praised his name all the way to my brother-in-law's house. And he asked me, what happened to you? I told him I got saved tonight. God made a difference in my life. I'm a new person now. I've been forgiven, but I kept on shouting for Jesus Christ. The beginning defines your direction. What you were when you first met Jesus Christ was defining what you were going to, what you ultimately were going to become. When you first met Jesus, you praised God. Are you praising God today? When you first met Jesus, you prayed every day. Are you praying today? When you first met Jesus, you wouldn't miss Bible study. Are you missing Bible study today? When you first met Jesus, there were things you put down and there were things you picked up. Have you picked up what you put down since you first met Jesus? Have you put down what you picked up since you first met the Lord? John reinforces that there are two certainties that he reinforces here. The believer needs to be reminded that this thing is real, that his faith is sound. You need to know that God is real and that your faith is sound. This is not a foolish story made up in a vacuum. Jesus Christ is a living reality. And the joy that you felt when you first met him is real, and there's still some more joy to be felt. This thing is real. And just because you are becoming lax, let me just say this, because I can see a lot of laxity around Southeast Community Church. Just because you are becoming lax doesn't mean Jesus is not real. Doesn't mean that God is not on the throne. Doesn't mean that people are not experiencing the power of God while you can't seem to hear his voice. We start getting lax. Somebody asked me, how can people get lax when they come to church every Sunday? You start taking baby steps away from Jesus. You don't want to accept the word of God. You don't want to implement what God is saying in your life. Yeah, you want to shout on Sunday, but you want to go do your thing the rest of the week. And so the joy you feel in the beginning, it gets lower and lower. And your energy for Christ gets lower and lower, because you're losing the joy of knowing Christ as your Savior and Lord. The second thing he says, it's real because of the life-changing experience that you have when you first met Christ. And the possession of eternal life. That is something that I can say to everyone. I know God is real because I can feel him deep down within my soul. I know he's real because of what he has done for me. I can't explain what he's done for you, but I know he's done something for me. I know what I used to be, and I know what I used to do. I know how I used to act. I know how quick I used to get mad. But when I met Jesus Christ, a change was made in my life. And listen, God ain't got to do nothing else for me. Since he lifted me out of that muck and miry crate and placed my feet on a solid rock to stay, I realize that he's real. He doesn't have to speak another word to me. Just because he changed me, I know he's real. How do I maintain this thrill? The second thing you have to do, you've got to reignite your sensibilities. You can't forget the experience that you had in Christ Jesus. There are five major senses that you have. And he uses in this verse, verse 1 and 2, he uses three of them to collaborate his story. Your audible sense, your sense of hearing, your vision sense, your visible sense of seeing, your tangible sense, your sense of handling things, touching, and even comprehensible, because he says we handled him. It goes a little bit farther. Every sensibility God has given you is a collective mechanism. It's just taking in information. Your ears, your eyes, your smell, your touch, your feelings. All they do is just take in, they gather in information. And what he is saying is that there are three compelling senses that you can use to gather in the fact that Jesus Christ is real. He says you could hear him. That's what he says in verse 1. And hearing was enough, but more compelling, we could see him. Seeing is enough, but even more conclusive, we could handle him. We could touch him. The proof that Jesus is real was all before our very eyes. In the Old Testament, hearing was enough. God never had to manifest himself. All God had to do was just speak. And today, all God has to do a miracle in your life, is just speak. The question is, are you hearing? God wakes up our sensibilities by just speaking. You know, when a baby is born, he's born with the full range of his hearing. hearing never increases, waxes, or wanes. They hear very well. That's why they can learn language so fast, because they're born with the full range of that hearing. But I've walked in many doctor's hospital rooms, and the doctor has said to me, they can't see. The seeing is gone. The doctor has said to me, they can't talk. The talking is gone. And I'm not sure that they can squeeze your hand. I wish I had a witness. But one thing I'm sure of, they can hear you. Because God uses that sensibility to reach to your heart. If God can get your ears, he can get your heart. Listen to me. They looked upon him. Two different words in the Greek there. They looked upon him. It means that they gazed at something until a long look had grasped something of meaning or something of significance in a person or thing. It's kind of like when you see somebody coming, you say, that looks like Jesus. But they're so far in the distance, you're just not sure. Have I got a witness? And so as they get closer, images come into focus. Have I got a witness? And see, I just want to put a pin right there. See, Jesus has to get closer to you for him to come into focus. Somebody ought to work with me here. That looks like Jesus. Well, he kind of walks like Jesus. I remember Jesus wearing that robe. His hair looks like Jesus. Those facial features look like Jesus. No, that is Jesus. You see, you go from a look to an understanding of who Jesus is. And the closer and closer and closer Jesus gets to you, the more you realize who he is. Heard him. Look, it's Jesus. But the text says, John says, I just want you to know we handled him. That God gets close enough to me and you to allow not only for him to touch, for him to touch you, but for you to touch him. We touched the nail prints in his hands. We saw the thumb prints upon his brow. We saw the nail prints in his feet. It really was Jesus in flesh and blood. Most scholars say he's talking about after the resurrection. That Jesus didn't get up as a spirit, but he got up in a resurrected body. He got up in bodily form. Resurrected body Jesus got up in. And so John says, we heard him as a living Savior. We saw him as a living Savior. We handled, touched him as a living Savior. Like a blind man in a dark, we touched him and we examined him and we know that he is real. He's real. God's real, I tell you. You might be losing your faith. You might be doubting God. You might be waxing in the church. You might be coming weak. But John says he is real. And that same real God that you met when you first got saved is the same real God that's still standing in the same place. You're the one that has walked away. Let me make the final point of this text. He says, if you want to maintain that thrill, reclaim the beginning, take me back. Take me back, dear Lord, to the place where I first believe. Take me back to that joy. Take me back to that peace
Take me back to that sense of serenity. Take me back to that sense of security. My job wasn't right, but I knew you held me in your hands. Things were going bad in my life, but you gave me peace in my soul. Take me back. He said, you got to reignite that sensibility. Jesus has become foggy in your mind. Jesus has become a distant memory, and you've got to let Christ get up close. You've got to see him for yourself. You've got to hear him. You've got to touch him. You've got to handle him. You've got to know this thing is real. I'm going to leave you alone in a minute. Listen to me. Third thing he says is you've got to be reminded of the gospel story. That's it. You and I have got to be reminded over and over of this gospel story. John says, we bear witness, which indicates that we have the authority of experience. I really just like to leave it alone right there. I can just bear witness that Jesus is real because I've experienced him. You can't make me doubt him because I know too much about him. I bear witness that he put running in my hand, in my feet. He put clapping in my hand. He put joy in my heart and peace in my mind. I bear witness that he picked me up. You may not know me before this time, but he picked me up, turned me around, and placed my feet on solid ground. I bear witness that he brought me out of darkness into the marvelous light. I bear witness that he can make a difference in your life if you call on his name. I don't care how low you suck. I don't care how bad it is. I can bear witness. Hey! That God is real. I can bear witness that he can save you. He can take a crooked stick and make a straight leap. I bear witness. He can make a guilty man good. I can bear witness. He can make a difference in your life. I can bear witness. He can pick you up. I can bear witness. He can clean you up. I can bear witness. He can straighten you up. I can bear witness. He can lift you up. I can bear witness. Hey! I'm not talking about what I heard my mama say. Have I got somebody? I ain't talking about what I heard my daddy say. I'm talking about what I experienced in my own soul. I bear witness that Jesus is real. I didn't get it secondhand. I got it firsthand. I met it for myself. Yes. Yes. And I'm declaring to you, I'm authorized by God. I've been anointed and appointed to tell you, you ain't got to give up your faith. You don't have to hold down your head. You don't have to become lax in your responsibilities. God is real. And that same Jesus that left us one day and took a cloud is coming back again. And he's coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle. Jesus is real. It's real because I can feel it. And I don't have to feel him on Sunday. I wish I had some true believers up in here. I feel him on Monday. I feel him on Tuesday. I feel him on Wednesday. I feel him in my midnight hour. I feel him when there's tears in my eyes. I feel him when there's pain in my heart. He's real.
Hey, I'm so glad God's real. I'm so glad he's real to me. The same Jesus can be real to you. He doesn't want to forgive you. He wants to have fellowship with you. He doesn't want to save you. He wants you to share life with him. Have I got somebody? He just doesn't want to keep you from going to hell. He wants to get some hell out of you. Jesus is real. And if you're going to experience the fullness of God, it's not just in the forgiveness that comes from Calvary. It's the fellowship that you have with the Christ every day. That's why he says your joy needs to be complete. Huh? I need complete joy. I need complete joy. I mean, you don't not want to get married and be happy the first week. I want to be happy every week. I need complete joy. I need this thing to stay on the honeymoon. I want to stay on the honeymoon with Jesus. And the way you stay on that honeymoon, you got to stay in fellowship with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. I want to challenge you with this one question. Are you still experiencing the same joy that you experienced when you first met Jesus? Have you veered off course? Have you become lax in your relationship with him? The things that you took so seriously, you would not let down, you guarded them so well. Have you begun to let those things go? Because you do understand anything can happen in a relationship. Some things are just inherently wrong if you're going to get the best out of a relationship. And if you're going to get the best out of a relationship with Jesus, it's not just about going to Calvary for forgiveness. It's about going to Calvary for fellowship. I messed up, Lord. I'm out of place. I haven't been living like I know how to live since I first met you. I veered off track. I'm feeling insecure. I'm feeling confused. But I know you saved me. I know you made a difference in my life. Now, Lord, I want the joy of knowing that you are there every day. I want the joy of knowing that no matter what situation I'm in, what I'm going through, no matter how dark it gets, I've got a friend in Jesus. We've got an intimate relationship. We talk all the time. He talks to me all the time. He constantly confirms to me that he will never leave me nor forsake me. That's what I want you to take me back to, Lord. That's what I desire in you. Believers, I want you to pray with me. This is my invitation to you. Lord, give me the joy that I had when I first met you. Somewhere I got away from it. People said I was praising you too much. People said I was too crazy about you. I made the whole world about Jesus. Give me that joy back, because it is all about you. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Let me pray with you. You want to pray for that joy? I want you to pray this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, it's in the name of Jesus that I come back to you to reclaim the relationship that we had from the very beginning. Fill my heart with that peace where things didn't bother me. Fill my heart with that joy that the world couldn't take away. Fill my heart with that love that I had for everybody. And Lord, reignite my sensibilities and make yourself as real to me as you once were. Father, I just want to thank you that you are God and you're God all by yourself. And the good news is that I can go to Calvary for forgiveness, but I can go to Calvary also for fellowship. God, make my relationship right with you today. Let my fellowship be pure. Let my fellowship be right. In Jesus' name. Come on, shout amen. You hear today, say, Pastor, I never experienced. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. I never experienced Christ as my Savior. I never experienced Christ.
I set out on a narrow way many years ago, hoping I would find true love along the broken road. But I got lost a time or two, wiped my brow and kept pushing through. I couldn't see how every sign pointed straight to you. That every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God bless the broken road that led me straight to you. Yes, it did. I think about the years I spent just passing through, trying to have the time I lost and give it back to you. But you just smile, take my hand. You've been there, you understand. It's all part of a grander plan that is coming true. Every long lost dream led me to where you are. The broken road that led me straight to you. hope the days come easy and the moments pass slow, and each road leads you where you wanna go. And if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, I hope you choose the one that means the most to you. And if one door opens to another door closed, I hope you keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, my wish for you is that this life becomes all that you want until your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to, I hope you know somebody loves you and wants the same thing. But you never forget all the ones who love you in the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret, and you help somebody every chance you get. Oh, you find God's grace in every mistake and always give more than you take. But more.